Hello everyone and welcome to chapter number 4 of our unit video tutorial series. And in today's video, we will have a look into the installation process of NGINX Unit using Homebrew on macOS. It's almost new to me as well. I'm using Mac, but not really a lot for development. But we will just dive into it and have a look what we can do with Homebrew. Homebrew is like a package manager, software manager for macOS or macOS based systems. And we're using that to actually install NGINX Unit using our Homebrew packages. Interestingly enough, a little nerdy side note here, that Homebrew is using extensively Ruby. I've just discovered that while I was looking into our packages and our definitions we wrote to make actually the whole Homebrew installation process work. So nerd fact number 965, Homebrew is using Ruby as a implementation language. All right, so back to the real topics. We can type normally brew install NGINX Unit if it's not hanging good. Brew control R again. Yes. So brew install dash V for verbose output, so we can actually see what happens under the hood. Because if you ask me, the whole Homebrew installation process, and you will see that in a minute, it will take some time to run. And the reason for that is it's different from what APT is doing, from what Jum Yellow Upgrade Manager for CentOS and Red Hat is doing. What you can see here now, it's like downloading the source files from our repositories, and now it runs actually configure command. And the configure command is needed to configure the make process that can build NGINX Unit and some of its dependencies. In this case, we are building NJS as we added that in 1.29. And the NGINX JavaScript runtime environment was added to NGINX Unit in the latest release 1.29. So what you can see here now is that Homebrew is like downloading source code, actually see source code, run configure, and after configure, it run make to make actually the binaries that we can use on our Mac system. And that is working with some C compiler stuff, with some shenanigans around all things building applications from C code and make the binary actually work. You will normally not see this output as you not specify the dash V or the verbose output option for your Homebrew. But I find it a little interesting to see, okay, what is the thing actually doing and why does it take like a couple of more minutes to install than a simple apt install unit command on an Ubuntu box, right? And we will come to building unit from source and what's needed to do this and what benefits do we have while building NGINX Unit from source actually, rather than using a package manager to install a pre-built package on a system in another chapter. And this output, like this configure and make output and how that looks like and the amount of time it'll take to make it actually compile is something we'll recognize while we are doing this on another system. All right, so now we can see it's saying creating build make file. And that is like that's what we do with configure, is we create this make file. And after creating the make file, we actually run make command. And that's what we do now, is we run make and make install. And I love this little beer emoji in Homebrew. That is my number one thing. So beer emoji means that we are actually good. We're good to go. And it tells us, hey, we have installed NGINX Unit successfully. The build took us like 2 minutes, 37 seconds, which is okay for an for like building NJS as well as unit from source and do some configure stuff. But actually now we would like to check if it was installed successfully. Typing which unit D again means that we can ask our system, hey, where is the unit D binary located? And it is user local bin unit D. Typing unit D dash dash help will give us our well-known help output. And similar to what we have in chapter number 5, talking about the installation of Windows subsystem for Linux and the installation of unit on WSL, it is similar with Mac here. I'm going to start unit here in a more developer-friendly way and version, especially the control API control endpoint will not listen on a Unix socket rather than on an IP address and port, because it's easier than for us to use curl and other tools to send actually JSON data to the control API endpoint or to modify our configuration. Okay, to start this, we are here. Let me see if I have to clean up some log files maybe. And actually let's start unit D. To start unit D on my Mac, what we do is we actually type unit D and then based on the help output, let's bring that back once more, unit D. So I will start with the control process, which is 100.001 port 9090. That will be our control endpoint in this case, which is a free port. You're totally fine to choose any port you want. In my case, I like 9090. That's it. So next one is we need to tell unit where to store the PID. And the same trick we do with in other tutorials as well, we can use WPD for the current work directory and then simply add slash unit PID. We would like to store a log file in a directory we're currently in called unit.log. We do not want to run in a demonized mode. So that means that we can actually see the output, what unit D sends to standard out and standard error is something we would like to print on screen. That's why we use the no daemon flag. All right. Anything else? The state directory can be used. Let's define a state that can be used to store the unit configuration, certificates, things like that. We are not using root here. So that means unit telling unit to run the non-privileged processes normally as a run user unit or nobody will not work in this case as the unit main process will not be operated by root. So yeah, that's what unit is telling us here. It says, hey, unit is running in unprivileged mode. We cannot use an arbitrary user and group, which is totally fine. It tells us unit 129.0 is started now, which is the latest version at the time of recording. So now we split the screen vertically. All right. And we do check if everything works as expected. We do localhost port 9090/config. Let's make this like, there you go, slash config. And as we see, we have the listeners and the applications up and running. So our unit install instance is was successfully installed on macOS using Homebrew. And we are able to query the configuration endpoint or the configuration API and print our default configuration, which is basically empty, empty listener, empty application. So that being said, we have now covered the installation process on macOS and all the rest of like configuring unit, using the unit config API, install application modules is a little bit different. Installation of modules is different on macOS than on other systems, but you can use Homebrew or the brew command for the language modules as well as the unit core binary. So make sure you check out the documentation about how to use the brew command to install unit and the language modules. All the configuration, using the config API, applying JSON configuration, install the applications, work with routes, etc., is absolutely identical regardless the operating system we are using. So that being said, I'm glad you were here. Now we have a unit installation running on macOS, and in the next chapters we will have a look into the application modules and the application code and what we can actually do with unit. Looking forward to that, and make sure you check this out and stay tuned. See you there. Goodbye.